going on that guy. He could see right into people and see who was good for me to be around and who was even safe for me to be around when I was very naive. And I'm just, I could say that I'm sad that he's gone, but I look at death in kind of a different way. He is in a grasp with our human minds, and I just know every time I go to Nightingale Studios, it will never be the same, and I will never be able to not think of him when I go there, and you just sometimes think it's going to last forever. I could imagine rehearsing there and growing old with Jay, and that wasn't to be, so all I can say is life is short, let's appreciate every day, and let's really appreciate the ones.
My name is CJ. Now, Jimmy?
And I'm DJ. I'm the voice behind the rap monotonous.
We are rap and roll. I just want to say I met Jay in like 89, 90, in Fresno. And as everyone knows, he was one of the good ones. You'll hear stories about him helping people, about him caring. He did. One thing I can say about him is he always had a sense of humor. He always made people laugh. And you could make him laugh by the simplest, stupid thing. He was just happy to laugh. I'm convinced he got his sense of humor from his father. After meeting his parents, I know why he turned out so good. I know he was involved in the church, and I think they raised a fine man, and I, for one, am going to miss him very much.
I met Jay when I first moved out here from Detroit with the band. We run into many parties. And I always look at everybody at Austin. Everybody had their beers and whiskeys and girlfriends and just knowing box office before it opened, and he was glowing. I didn't ask for details. Love you, Jerry.
Master. My life and Kevin, Jimmy. Crazy thing is, for whatever it's worth, why he never mentioned it to me that he was that sick. Maybe it's to save my feelings, or that he didn't want me to feel sorry for him, which I'm sure he knew that I wouldn't because I was on behind 27, like behind him. He was like my brother. And it took me a minute to get past it. Not having him around anymore, not having that one two moment in time to spend with him at least one more time. That's probably what hurts me the most. And I just thank God that I have him in my life. God bless you all.
I'm not going to sit here and tell you. Well, I'm going to tell you where it comes from, Chad. A few months ago, we lost another friend of ours, Sean Hogan, and Bobby and I, but he was friends with Jay. And Jay ran, like I said, he ran over. And sometimes we would have parties. So one day he calls me up and he says, "Hey, Charlie, man, you're the carniest out of King, man." I said, "Yeah, I am, man. What do you want? You want me to cook up for you?" "Yeah." He says, "I got home this Well, Sean and I got a little inebriated at that point. And I dared Sean to put some 151 in his mouth and blow it out of the fire. Well, Sean did. Cheryl took a picture of it. Jay comes running over. He goes, "Man, what are you doing, man? You set the place on fire." And I said, "Yeah." Sean and I looked at each other like, "Ah, man."
That's funny.
My name is Jackie, and just felt like I needed to say a couple of things. I wasn't going to come up here, but I just feel like I owe it to Jay to just tell him how much I appreciate him. And I met Jay years ago, because it was two versions of Nightingale. It was a studio that was down on Burbank. It was the old studio. And I had booked a room there to rehearse. And when I walked in, he looks at me and goes, "Hey, are you from?" And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "I love your band." So I remember somebody said that he was very complimentary about it. If he liked your band or liked you, you know, appreciated your music, he would come out and tell you, and that is pretty rare. So from that point, I would run into him here and there at the clubs, and it wasn't until I started rehearsing at the studio up here, close by here, that we really developed a closer relationship. And, you know, I was here with jangling keys going up and down the hallways. So over the years of rehearsing there, I got to a point where I was talking, you know, he'd love to talk, and I was talking about how much of a drag it was for me to haul my drum kit into play and tear it down and this and that. He worked out a deal where if I would go in and clean up the drum sets and change the heads and kind of drum tech the gear there, he worked out a deal with Mike where I could have a locker there for free so that I could set up and play. And so I spent a little over a summer doing that. And during that time of working at Nightingale, teching their drums and playing, we got really, really close, and we would have these long conversations. Just about everything under the sun, really deep conversations about life. Crazy conversations about when the economic collapse would come, that he would turn Nightingale into a fortress. We could all come and hang out there, and we could say, and we'd barbecue, and I swear to God, the next week he started collecting canned food. And he opened up this locker that was next to my drum locker, and he had this food. Wow, enough spam. You know, and every now and then he'd be edgy and stuff, but boy, on a dime, he would just turn around and be the sweetest guy. He had the biggest heart, and absolutely, Nightingale will never be the same. I can't even imagine pulling into that parking lot and not having Jay come out. And when I found out he was in the hospital, and not many people knew, he was in the intensive care unit, and I was right there. And he still wanted to go back to work. He was really concerned about being at the studio. I got to get back to work. I just wanted to shed a little light. He was a really great guy. Man, I'm gonna miss him forever. It's just a huge, huge loss, but he's in a much better place, and we'll see each other again.
I'm Billy. I met Jay about 20 years ago.
five or six times between his tits with Sean, that's what I would call him. And he would